BGMC. The biblical truth lives here.
The ancient Hebrew scriptures foretold of the Anointed One, Yeshua HaMashiach. The Messiah Yeshua came to call the people back to the truth of His word and to follow that righteous path. Yeshua then called Jewish men to be His disciples, and after His death and resurrection, those Jewish men told the world about the Jewish Messiah. Now, after 2,000 years, Beth Goyim Messianic Congregation has that same calling of those Jewish men, telling all people, both Jew and Gentile, about the proper ancient path, teaching the Route 66 King's Highway from Genesis through to Revelation, and how you need and can get back to the proper roots of the faith and a closer walk with God. Now, let's hear the message.
Let's go get a blessing because we persevered through the storm. Turn to Leviticus 12, verse 3. Leviticus 12, verse 3. What we're doing is we're going over the 613 laws of the Lord. We're going over those 613 laws. We're going to be going over through category 3. But what also we're going to be doing is also tying it together with the Brit Hadasha. Okay? This third category is the category of signs and symbols, signs and symbols. Okay, there are many different signs that the Lord wants in our lives that we should be doing. Sorry, I'm just trying to fix the tallit now that it's all slipped beyond my back there a little bit. So here in Leviticus 12, verse 3, Leviticus 12, verse 3, Vayikra 12, verse 3, on the eighth day, the baby's foreskin is to be circumcised. Okay, this particular, since as we learned last week in our preface to all the laws that Yeshua said in Matthew 5 verse 18, that it is the, you know, every jot, no jot or tittle will be missing from the law until heaven and earth pass away. Okay, so this particular key here, sorry, let me just fix this now. This particular sign that all males are to have is an honor, that it is a private sign for us men to have between. So the only people that are going to know that we have this sign is our mothers who are changing our diapers and our wives who will, during marital relations, have the honor of seeing that part of a man's body. Okay, so it is something that is still to be kept to this day. Now, it is very interesting, a little note to know about this, that on the eighth day, why the Lord said about the eighth day, medically, since, you know, the Lord is the great physician, medically, it is vitally important because, you know, if a baby loses a little drop of blood like this much, it is a lot to a baby. See, when you do the circumcision and you do it properly, the baby will barely bleed maybe a drop or two of blood, and most likely none at all, okay? Because on the eighth day, there is a thing that it's called the clotting factor in our blood, which is the very highest on the eighth day after the child's birth. Okay, now, why is that important to know? Because now let's just see if we see this particular sign and symbol in the Brit Hadasha, the New Testament. Going on to the next slide. We're on slide number 19 for the tech department. If you turn in your Bible to Luke chapter 2, verse 21, Luke chapter 2, verse 21. Luke chapter 2, verse 21. Sorry about all the technology fun tonight, but you know what? Hey, for something as special as learning the laws of God, it's worth it to wait. Luke chapter 2, verse 21, the good doctor, Luke chapter 2, verse 21. On the eighth day, when it is time for his Brit Milah, he was given the name Yeshua, which is what the angel had called him before his conception. Okay, so you see, in the Brit Hadasha, we do have this. We do have the Lord Yeshua, Messiah, being circumcised by his Iman Abba, his mother and his father. It is so he was fully man and fully God, even though he was a baby. You know, if we were not to do the circumcision anymore, well, the wheel could have fallen off the wagon. The donkey that they're riding, since they were poor, could have become lame. You know, anything could have happened if this covenant were to was supposed to stop. And now, the other key about this is that we're supposed to be, you know, as people call many of us Christians, I'm a Messianic Jew, but you call Christians, you're supposed to be Christ-like. So if you're not doing this circumcision to your children on the proper day, then you are not being Messiah-like, okay? Now, the other part about this that's very important, this is a side note of this particular topic, is his name will be called Yeshua, okay? It's not Jesus. That's a Catholic name, and it didn't start till 500 years ago, okay? So here, his name will be Yeshua because it says the angel gave him this name beforehand, okay? It also is in the Matthew Gospel, Matthew chapter 1, verse 21, about his name, and it says he will save his people from their sins, and that's what the name Yeshua means. But here you see in the Tanakh, the Old Testament, in the Torah, and now you see in the Brit Hadasha that we still are doing this. And then also, what is also vitally important is that Shaul also circumcises Timothy. Okay, Shaul, Paul, also circumcises Timothy. And, you know, people go, well, it's because of the Sanhedrin. Well, God is either God or he's not. You can't have it both ways. You're not going to fear man and not fear God, okay? So Paul does circumcise Timothy. Going on to the next slide, we're going on to Category 4. Go back to Deuteronomy, Devarim 6, verse 4 and 5. Devarim 6, verse 4 and 5. Devarim, Deuteronomy 6, verse 4 and 5. The fourth category of the 34 categories is called the prayer and blessing. Okay, prayers and blessings. There are certain prayers and blessings that we are to do in the Torah, and we are still to keep them today. And this particular subcategory is called to say the Shema in the morning and at night. In the morning and at night. Okay? And Devarim 6. Verse 4 and 5, Deuteronomy 6, verse 4 and 5. Shema Yisrael, Yehovah Eloheinu, Yehovah Echad, and to love Yehovah Elohim with all your heart, with all your being, and with all your resources. Okay, if you go on reading a little further, it says, and in verse 7, it says, and you're to teach this to your children when you get up and when you go to bed, and when you're riding on the road, and when you're all these different things, okay? All the time. In the morning, when you get up, and that is in verse 7. And in the evening, when you go to bed. Let me just get that really quick here. Sorry, it's not on the slide. Verse 7, it says, and you're to teach them carefully to your children. You're to talk about them when you sit at home, and when you're traveling on the road, and when you lie down, and when you get up. Okay, specifically in verse 7 at the end, about the times that you're to do this. When you lie down, okay, that'll be at night. And when you get up in the morning, you say, Shema, hear Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. Okay? That is the commandment that we are to do. Okay? And you're to love Elohim with all your heart, with all your being, and all your resources. Okay? It starts here with these blessings. Okay? If you start your day in this category 4, if you're starting your day with prayer and blessings, okay? And you're saying the Shema over your children, and you're teaching your children, and you're saying the Shema over your children when you go to bed, you're saying the Shema over your wife, you're saying your Shema over your family, okay, over your home, in the morning and the evening, you're bookending the Word of God in your home. So this is what the foundations of our homes are. And in this category, you know, who would say to stop doing this, okay? So it is vitally important to start your day with this prayer, okay? When you lie down and when you get up, not 2 hours later, okay? When you get up, starting your day is, let me hear the word of the Lord. Let me know that he is my king, Eloheinu, our God. Shema Yisrael, The Lord our God, the Lord is echad. He is one with us. If we are following his commandments, he wants to be with us. That's why he said, build the Beit HaMikdash or the Mishkan in the desert, because he wanted to be with us. If you start your day and end your day, a lot of people don't. You know, they don't start their day. And if you don't start your day with the word of God, then things tend to go wrong. Okay, sometimes days can be okay or whatever, but why not start with the perfect words? Okay, Shema Yisrael, Yehovah Eloheinu, Yehovah Echad, and you're to love Yehovah Elohim with all your heart, with all your being, with all your resources, with all your heart. Okay, what is all of our heart? Okay, we want to do it with not just parts of it, but with all of our heart. Now, what's that? Now, why is that important? Because if you start your day with the word of God, and you end your day with your word of God, then everything in the middle should have, you know, much more shalom involved in it. Going on, let me slow down a little bit. Going on to the next slide. Going on to the next slide. Be good if I'm on that. Okay. Going on to the next slide. Now turn to Mark. Mark chapter 12. Mark chapter 12. Verse 29 through 31. Now, the reason that we're doing this on both sides of it, because you want to see that the Torah is still in effect in the Brit Hadashah, in the Gospels, throughout the whole of the Brit Hadashah, the New Testament. Because once you get your foundation, then when you're seeing Yeshua's words, specifically in the Gospel, Mark 12, verse 29 through 31, when you're seeing his words, you now have the foundation, because God's word will never contradict itself. So once you have the foundation of category 4 of starting your day and ending your day, now also remember, as we read in the Brit Hadashah, Yeshua is a Hebrew or a Jew, and he's talking to Hebrews because he's the king of the Jews. He's talking to the Jews. Now they're going to understand something. It is our honor, our job, to now put our self into that position so that we fully comprehend the teaching. Mark 12, verse 29 through 31 states, Yeshua answered, the most important is Shema Yisrael, Yehovah Eloheinu, Yehovah Echad, and you are to love Yehovah Elohim with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your understanding, with all your strength. The second is this, you are to love your neighbor as yourself. There is no other mitzvah greater than these. Okay, the church likes to then surpass that, you know, and say, well, we only have to follow these two. Okay, let's go with that. Let's go with that lie. Okay, if I'm to start my day with the word of God, then, and if I'm to end my day with the word of God, what am I supposed to do in the middle of the day? You know, what am I supposed to do at work? Should I go steal? Should I, let's say it's nice weather. Should I look at the girls at work? You know, when the girl's bending over, should I look at her? Okay, no, right? It says there are no greater laws, there are no laws greater than these. Why? Because this is your foundation. Okay, starting your day, you know, Yeshua was saying start your day, because he didn't go in to verse 7. That we see in Devarim 6, he didn't say verse 7. Why? Because the Jews already knew it. But it is we, you know, the people 2,000 years later, you're 2,000 years away from this beginning, and you got all this corruption in your mind because the defect is in the children. Because each time we get further away, each generation, we get more corrupted, and we need to go back to the beginning. Okay? So here, let's read Mark chapter 12, verse 29 through 31 again. Yeshua answered, the most important is Shema Yisrael, Yehovah Eloheinu, Yehovah Echad. And you are to love Yehovah Elohim with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your understanding, and with all your strength. The second is this, you're to love your neighbor as yourself. There's no other mitzvot greater than these. Because why? What's he talking about, greater? Well, we're supposed to start the day. So if you're supposed to start each and every one of your days, as Devarim 6, 7 said, if you don't start every day with this greatest commandment, with a commandment, so let's say, well, I'm not low talk mode. No, not that one. Okay? So here, what you're supposed to start is with the greatest. Here, I want to hear from God. I want to understand from God. There's nothing else greater than this. This is what Yeshua is saying. He's not saying get rid of it. He's saying do more of it. See, this is the opposite of what the church thinks because they're all in the flesh. And unfortunately, many Messianic congregations that don't teach this. The reason is we need to have the foundation. There's nothing greater than here, Israel. Here, Israel, the Lord our God, He's one. So we have to become one with Him, not with me. We have to become one with the Word. Who's the Word? Yeshua is the Word. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. So in the morning and the night, because you want to say this over your family. You want to say this over your children. You want to say this over your wives. You want to say this over your employees. Here, let's start our day before we start our work day. Wouldn't that be great? If you had your own company and you start your work day and everybody that works there, hey, we're doing this. And if you don't do this, you're fired. Okay? You know, that way the homosexual wants to come in, sure, we'll hire you. But here you're going to listen to the Word of God each and every day. Okay? So here, Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. This is what we do. Okay? So here, when you want to put it away, it is absolutely satanic. So anybody who says, you know, well, this is the only two laws we got to follow. Absolutely. Because this is the beginning of everything else. Because I'm going to hear what? Hear Satan or hear the Lord. How am I? It says in verse 31, you're to love your neighbor as yourself. Well, how am I supposed to do that? Shema. Hear the word of God. Follow the word of God. Get blessings from God. Very simple. You're to love your Lord your God with all your soul. Why? Because I'm starting in the morning. Starting in the morning with His Word, I'm ending my day with His Word. No matter what, if you start and end with it, things will likely go better, even if there's trouble. If you start and end, you know that there is a God in heaven. So no matter what occurs, if you're truly following the Word, you'll have strength. The Shema gives us strength because we're plugging into God in the morning. This is what Yeshua is saying. Hear, Israel, the Word is speaking to you. Hear, Israel, your strength is by plugging into the Word of God. Because why? Teach your children. If you go back to the other category, teach your children, train up a child in the way that they should go and they won't depart. Proverbs 22, verse 6. So if you have that understanding, then when you bring this category 4 to the Brit Hadasha, the New Testament, you understand a greater understanding. He's trying to get them to come back because why? They're living in a Hellenistic society. The Romans are there. The pagans are there. Those heathen people that worship dog do. Okay? They're the ones that are there. And we're living in that community. So you love under God, the Lord your God with all your understanding. He's saying, come back, not go away. Category 4 is vitally important about prayers and blessings that we find in Torah, not the Talmud. For the Talmud has errors in it, tremendous errors, especially if you're following Rashi. What? The guy was definitely not all there. Okay? So here, hear the word of God, understand the word of God with all your soul. This is how we start our day. Everything, give your day to God first, then everything else will become easier. That's what the Lord our God is telling us. Start with me. Remember me, and then I'll make everything else better. You know, it's sort of like the Lord's formulated prayer. Our Father who art in heaven, holy is your name. Start with that. Start with the Shema. Shema Yisrael, Yehovah Eloheinu, Yehovah Echad. That's where he starts to get the formula. Okay? This is why the categories of the law and why we're to keep the law are so important. It is the strength of the Word of God. Going on to the next category. We're going on to category 5. Turn back to Vayikra, Leviticus 19, verse 16. This category is called love and brotherhood. This is one of the categories that gets trampled on, especially in the congregations and the churches that, you know, this is, it's rampant. It's unfortunate. But if everybody were to love the Lord thy God with all their heart, they would not break this category. This is category 5 of 34. Love and brotherhood is the topic. And here it is not to stand by idly when a human life is in danger. Well, what does that mean? Leviticus 19, verse 16. Let me just get a little drink of water while you look at that. Do not go around spreading slander among your people, but also don't stand idly by when your neighbor's life is at stake. I am Jehovah. Now, there's two parts of this particular commandment. So it can be put into two categories or two laws. When you get to the 613, you see parts and parts and parts and parts. Okay? Do not go around spreading slander among your people. That's one part. That's one of the laws. Okay? So if you have something bad to tell about somebody, shut up. Okay? Shut up. Just don't go spreading it unless somebody's life is in danger. Okay? If a child's life is in danger because the person is a pedophile, well, stop them. Don't let them be near them. That's not spreading slander. That's saving a life, because that's the second part of this verse. But also don't stand idly by when your neighbor's life is at stake. The little child's life is at stake because the pedophile wants to go, you know, the man wants to go into the girl's bathroom with all this disgusting homosexual stuff that we have. That's just a recipe for disaster. We've already had women being raped because of this stupidity. So we're not to stand by and let them go and do this. We're not to stand by idly when your neighbor's life is at stake. Okay? Here, first of all, in slander. Okay? This is lashon hara. Lashon meaning tongue, hara meaning evil speak. Okay? Don't go around spreading slanders. Okay? Stop them. If you hear people in the congregation talking when somebody's not there and they're not talking positive, or, you know, they're talking positive, well, that's a good thing. Hey, did you hear so-and-so is pregnant? Oh, they've been wanting a child for so long. That's positive. You know, and you say, hey, did you hear so-and-so was sleeping around? You don't spread that. Okay? And then when somebody is spreading that, you say, you know what? You really need to shut your mouth, because it's not positive what you're speaking. You're not speaking life, you're speaking evil. Okay? So the Lord says, don't let this keep going, because you know what happens? Things spread and they also change. And they also grow like weeds. So the Lord is saying, don't stand by idly when your neighbor's life is at stake, because here something that was misunderstood can then be spread further, and then somebody can, you know, lose business, and all this crazy stuff has happened. And the reason that things are bad is because nobody stopped the slander. Okay? Now let's see if that is in the Brit Hadasha. Let's take this full understanding. I'm not letting, you know, things, your neighbor, you got to stop it. Don't stand idly by when your neighbor's life is at stake. And Jehovah says, I am Jehovah. Listen to what I'm saying. You know, are you your brother's keeper? And the answer is yes. Going on to the next slide. Now we're going on to the Brit Hadasha. We're going to go to two readings. Now that we have a full understanding of Category 5, turn to 1 Timothy 3, verse 11. 1 Timothy, verse 3, verse 11. Chapter 3, verse 11. Sorry, chapter 3, verse 11. 1 Timothy, chapter 3, verse 11. Okay? Now with the understanding of the Torah, Now you're going to fully understand what the rabbi, you know, people think Paul is saying get rid of the Torah. Absolutely not. Actually, he confirms the Torah with so much of his writings. 1 Timothy chapter 3, verse 11. There's going to be two readings we're going to go through this chapter in this category in this in the Brit Hadasha. 1 Timothy chapter 3, verse 11. Similarly, the wives must be of good character, not gossips, but temperate, faithful in everything. Amen? Okay? So leadership and people in the congregation need to fully understand that gossip, and here even Paul was dealing with this because he was dealing with a baby messianic congregation. Remember, they're not churches. They're not churches. They're kehilats. They're congregations. The church wasn't birthed. The church was not birthed until the year 315 with Constantine and Pope Sylvester I at the Council of Nicaea. Okay, go look it up. Okay, so here in chapter 3, verse 11, we're still dealing with it, and we're saying a wives of the leadership must be of good character. Sometimes we get wives that love to chit-chat, 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 and chit-chat, and more chit-chat. Those girls love to talk, right? They love to talk, 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 talk. That's why, you know, men, you know, we got two ears because we need to listen twice as much because our wives will just keep, okay? So here, let's read that verse again. Similarly, the wives must be of good character, not gossips, but temperate, faithful in everything. Okay, once you understand that the wife of the leader, or even wives in the congregation, ladies in the congregation, must be of good character. Well, what is good character? They don't go around spreading gossip. They don't go around spreading gossip. They're faithful. Faithful what? Shema Yisrael, Yehovah Eloheinu, Yehovah Echad. Hearing the word of God, protecting. So another woman is talking, because the ladies, especially here, the Latinas love to talk. If there's not a fire going on, they're not happy. It's terrible, because, but that's part of their culture. There are some cultures that people are in everybody's business, and that's not what God wants. Okay? They love to talk. They love to make things bigger than they are. Okay, so here in the Brit Hadasha, Shaul was dealing with this, and he was saying to his baby messianic congregation, this is what I want for your leadership. This is what I want for the congregation. Don't be gossips. Now let's take that a little further. Now let's see what the disciple, the Talmud, Peter says. So turn to 1 Peter chapter 2. 1 Peter chapter 2. 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 1 and 2. 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 1 and 2. Hopefully everybody's getting something over there. Can even make this like this. 1 Peter chapter 1. 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 1 and 2. Therefore, rid yourselves of all malice, all deceit, hypocrisy, and envy, and all the ways there are speaking against people. And be like newborn babies, thirsty for the pure milk of the word, so that by it you may grow up into deliverance. So once again, we see Kepha, the Talmud of Yeshua, a very great man of God. He says, get rid of all the ways to speaking against people. Oh, that's category 5 of the law. Okay? Stop being gossips. You know, sometimes even men get into it too. Hey, did you hear so-and-so lost his job again? Huh? You know, he got a ticket. You know, people love, God wants you against this. And you see both Paul and Kepha, Shaul and Kepha, both saying, don't do this. Now, if you want to say get rid of the law, then let's gossip about anybody. Hey, did you hear what Elisheva did? Did you hear what Miriam? No. So if you want to get rid of the law, then let's start gossiping about people. And then people go, no. Hey, you can't have it both ways. It's all or nothing with God. It's all or nothing. So here, read verse 1 again. Therefore, rid yourselves of all malice, of all deceit, hypocrisy, and envy, and all the ways there are speaking against people. Okay? There's certain times that we have to speak against people, such as a demonic theology. Okay? We have to speak against that. You know, such as Paula White putting on her Facebook page, you know, being in a Little Red Riding Hood costume, and her new husband, because she's divorced, that was also public. You know, they were doing Halloween at their church. So we have, that's not gossip. They put it on their Facebook page. I didn't know she was Little Red Riding Hood in a very low-cut dress at that. So that's not speaking, but against somebody, that's saying don't go to their church, because why? They're teaching heresy. That's different than saying, hey, did you see so-and-so lost their job? Hey, did you see she was a little too close to him? Okay, that's different. When there's theology, that it goes strictly against the word, then we must speak up. But first of all, go to the person directly, then take it to a broader spectrum. That's not gossip. If you've taken it to the word, taken it to the person, you're still fulfilling the need of category 5. If somebody's going to be going to Sheol because of their sin, which Miss White is going to be, since she's promoting Satan's day, I don't think the Lord is going to let her into his house. Don't think so. Going on to the next category, we're going to go on to category 6. We're going to try to finish this set. We're going to do 10 categories. Each week we're going to try to do 10 categories and then go back again after we finish all 34 and go back again to each one of the laws in the categories. We're going to give you one law per category. We're now going to category 6, the poor and unfortunate. Turn to Leviticus 19, verse 9. Leviticus 19, verse 9. I know why the Lord had us wait. It's quiet. The Lord had us wait because froofiness. Leviticus 19, verse 9. This category is category number 6 of 34 that we're breaking it down. This is a category called poor and unfortunate. And here, something North Carolina instilled this week in their laws for starting in calendar year 2016 in the secular, not to reap the entire field. Okay? This is God's welfare system. God said this in Leviticus 19, verse 9. When you harvest the ripe crops produced in your land, don't harvest all the way to the corners of your field, and don't gather the ears of grain left by the harvesters. Okay, so what the Lord is saying is leave a portion of your field so that people can come who are poor or orphans or widows and go work for themselves to go get some food. That's God's welfare system. What we have in the United States is terrible, okay? Because people just stay on the welfare system, stay on the welfare system, stay on the welfare system. What one of our states in the United States did this past week is passed a bill that if you're on public assistance, you have to work for the government for a certain amount of hours per month. And if you don't, they cut your public assistance. Yes. Okay. Now, there are certain times when, you know, you do get hit, and it should be for a very small portion of time where you're, you know, if you have a good government. But here, the Lord's his government is this. You've got a field. Leave that corner, a certain section, not like a, you know, little piece, a certain section that's going to be enough for and it's corners. And if you've got a field, there's four corners. Okay? You leave that area so that, you know, the widow Martha, she can come and go pick the food herself. One, what that does is it gives people a lift. I picked it myself. Nobody gave me a handout. Gives honor and dignity to those who may be poor. So here in this category, we're helping the poor and unfortunate to help them have dignity in God, because what we're supposed to be is a community that cares about one another. Here, I've left that for you. Go ahead, take whatever there. And if I drop something on the ground, go ahead, take it. It's yours. Okay, anything that's on the ground, go ahead. If it fell from the tree, go ahead, take it. It's yours because the Lord's going to provide for me. So you leave the ears of grain left by the harvesters. Leave them there. Let the poor, let them feel the love of God, because, you know, sometimes when you hit rock bottom, you need a little bit of a pick-me-up. And by going and picking the food yourself, it gives you, I was still able to do that and to provide for my family. Because sometimes God puts you in a little bit of a squish. And, you know, and you need this little handout to help get your self-esteem back up so you can start serving the Lord. I know it's a believer, you know, you're supposed to have self-esteem, but see, the Lord knows. Here, you overextended yourself, something you did made the Lord angry, and he didn't bless something you did. So now he's saying, here, I still love you. Now go get some. It's a great category. Going on to the Brit Hadasha of category 6, we're now going to turn to the book of James. James chapter 1. Yaakov. James chapter 1, verse 27. Yaakov chapter 1, verse 27. James chapter 1, verse 27. It states this: the religious observance that God the Father considers pure and faultless is this: to care for orphans and widows in their distress, and to keep oneself from being contaminated by the world. So here, Yeshua's brother, Yaakov, I believe this is fully Yeshua's brother, as you read in the book of Acts, chapter 1 and 2, his brothers were believers once we hit Shavuot in Acts chapter 2. You see, now he's writing to care for orphans. Why? Because that's category 6. We should care for the orphan, and to keep oneself from being contaminated by the world. The world says, don't care about people. The world says, don't provide, you don't have enough. If I got some and you don't have any, I'm going to share with what I got. Even though it may not be a lot, I'm going to share. And this is one of the categories that we fully need to understand with what's going on around the world in all this upheaval in the world since the Lord is raising up these heathen called Muslims. What they did in France today, okay? What they're doing in Israel by stabbing so many people, and you can watch the YouTube videos about it. He's raising up this evil because we've forgotten him. So once things do escalate into what we see in the book of Revelation and the fourth seal being open, we're going to need to understand that we need to share with one another, okay? Care for the orphans and widows. We share. If I got something, we all got something. And we all might just have a little, but at least we got something, because that's the Torah. And anybody who says we shouldn't follow this anymore, then you're just satanic. I'm sorry I have to keep saying it, but I hear so many times people say we're not under the law. But why is this bad? Why is this bad? It is good. It is God's word. It is perfect. So here Yaakov is saying, care for the orphans and widows. We're going to have a lot of people that are going to need our compassion. And you know what? If you're following Torah and you love Yeshua, you're going to have stuff. But people are going to come. And you're going to feed them the word of God first, and I'm going to feed you food second. Because God first, food second. And I'll care for you. And I'll say, the reason I'm caring for you is because Yaakov in the Brit Hadasha said in chapter 1, verse 27, I have to care for you because that was in the Torah. It's all one book. It's a beautiful book. It's an awesome book. It's a book to live our lives by. Going on to category 7. Category 7, going back to the Torah. Deuteronomy 10, Devarim 10, verse 19. Devarim 10, verse 19. This category is called treatment of the Gentiles. Treatment of the Gentiles. Treatment of the Gentiles. The subcategory is to love the stranger. Subcategory of category 7, treatment of the Gentiles, is to love the stranger. Deuteronomy, Devarim 10, verse 19. Devarim 10, verse 19. Spirit is blowing. Therefore, you are to love the foreigner, since you were foreigners in the land of Egypt. Amen? You're to love the foreigner, since you were foreigners in the land of Egypt. The Lord keeps, it's constant. A constant theme. You know, I noticed that when we did the reading. You know, it was beautiful to do the reading in the Shemitah. We did the Shemitah and following what Israel did this past year. So we read the whole Torah in like a two-day sitting. And you see pervasive themes that go on through each and every book. And you're like, didn't we read that last time? Didn't we read that in another book? Didn't we? You know, sometimes when you sit there and you read the whole thing in a very short amount of time, this was one of the themes. Why does the Lord not want us to forget the foreigner? They've been so mean to us, but he says, don't. Shine my light and I'll make you the head. Treat them, love the foreigner. Since you were a foreigner and you were treated bad, show them love of the Torah. Feed them. Hey, goyim, you know, you're hungry. Here in our Torah, it says, I got to leave this for those people, the foreigners. You're a foreigner. And what is a foreigner? A person who is not from the seed of Abraham, Yitzhak, and Yaakov. That's a foreigner. Okay? So here, hey, go, you know, this is what our God told us to do. Here. Really? I'd never do that. Well, you don't serve our God. But you can. Because here, we show love and compassion in accordance with the law. In accordance with the law. Love the stranger. Because God's reminding us, you know what? You were strangers. You know? I was a stranger and you didn't... When, Lord, were you... When, Lord, did we see you? When, Lord? Oh, let's go to the Brit Hadasha. Well, I didn't do that one. 1 John. Let's go to the next slide. 1 John 3. I love those letters. Love the John letters. 1 John 3:17-18. 1 John 3:17-18. I'll give you a second to find it because it's a little book. 1 John 3:17-18. Let's see, in the picture here. Okay, looks like they all got it. Oh, they're falling asleep. 1 John 3:17-18. If someone has worldly possession and sees his brother in need, yet closes his heart against him, how can he be loving God? Children, let us love not with words and talk, but with actions and in reality. Oh, he's talking about love the foreigner. Because remember the whole thing that Shaul and Peter got into? Shaul and Kepha got into? Okay, because Kepha didn't want to go to the Gentiles because he needed to be shown the vision and go see those people. Go talk to them. Go bring them the truth. Well, here, let's not love with words or talk, but with actions. Say, here, foreigner, goyim, go... Here, you don't have any food? Here's my field. Here, take this corner. It's marked off for you guys. Take everything you want. Share with everybody, because that's all I'm giving. Because God said, leave the corners. Let us love with not words, but with actions. This is what he's talking about. It is confirming what the Torah said. The actions. Not that what you want to do, is what God wants you to do. What Jehovah wants you to do. This is how you should read the Brit Hadasha. It is a fulfillment of all the words that we see in Torah. They're not broken words, but once you get your full understanding from the category 7 that you're to care for these people, even though they're not our family. So it is, when Yeshua said, when did we care for you, Lord? When did we see you, Lord? When did we go to prison with you, Lord? What you do for the least of these, you do for me. That's fulfillment of category 7. Isn't that interesting? Going on to the next slide. Category 8. Category 8 is marriage, divorce, and family. Turn to Deuteronomy 5, verse 16. Subcategory is to honor Abba and Ima, father and mother, right? Deuteronomy, Devarim 5, verse 16, this is category 8 of 34. We'll be going to category 10 tonight in this Erev Shabbat message. And if you miss any of it, it is on our website, okay? It is under the Absolute Truth, the 613 laws, right there on the head page. And there's another thing you can get. You can even view this now on your smartphone. We have a Beth Goyim app. Come to our website and download it on your phone, and then you can do it right from your phone. TheBethGoyim.org, BethGoyim.org, and then you can get the Beth Goyim app for your smartphone. You can listen to our radio station anywhere around the world. Cool. Deuteronomy 5, verse 16, and it's free. Honor your father and mother, as Jehovah your Elohim ordered you to do, so that you will live long and have things go well with you in the land Jehovah your Elohim is giving you. Okay, so this category, marriage, divorce, and family, this particular one is about your mother and your father. Okay, father. Okay, this is really very important to understand that this category does not go away. We're still to honor mother and father. How do I know they're my mother and father? Because I call them that. The Av and Ima, mother. Okay, Im and Av. Okay. Now, because this also gets people confused when Yeshua talks about calling nobody else father except for your father in heaven. If you would read the whole chapter, that you would see that he's not really saying that. He's saying, don't elevate yourself, because he's not contradicting this commandment. He's not contradicting this eighth category. Honor. What does it mean to honor your father and mother? Honor them by being a good child, okay? Honor them by keeping respect in the family's name. Because if you dishonor your father, you're disrespecting your family name. You're bringing disrespect to the family. Honor your mother because she's the one who gave you birth. Honor her because you're supposed to protect her if your father's not around. Honor your father. Now let's take this further. To those who say we don't need the law anymore, who is our ultimate father? The Father in heaven. Honor him. So if you say we don't need his law anymore, are you honoring your father? Well, Dad said this one day, and he said something else the next day. Okay? Then it can cause confusion of the children. Okay? Here, if you honor your father, ultimately in heaven, what does he promise? Devarim 28 promises you a lot in those first 14 verses. If you honor him, he's going to make you the head and not the tail. How many people want to be the head and not the buttocks, right? Here, if you honor in category 8, then you'll live long. And it doesn't say you'll live long but be sickly. You'll live long and be prosperous. Because you'll live long in the land and that'll be good. Everything will be peaceful. Now take that understanding. Take that understanding. We're going to go to the Brit Hadasha. We're going to go to the Brit Hadasha. Turn to Matthew 15. This is going to have two readings. Matthew 15, verse 4 through 6. Matthew 15, we're going to take this part and we're going to add to it. Matthew 15, verse 4 through 6. Matthew 15, verse 4 through 6. This is still in the category number 8, the Brit Hadasha reading of marriage, divorce, and family. For God said, honor your father and mother, and anyone who curses his father and mother must be put to death. But you say, if anyone says to his father or mother, I have promised to give to God what I might have used to help you, then he is rid of his duty to honor his father and mother. Thus, by your tradition, you make null and void the word of God. What did we have in the other category? Take care of the poor person, the unfortunate. So if your parents are gotten old and they've gotten sick, then it's your honor as their son or daughter to take care of them, okay? If you don't take care of them, you're ridding your duty of what Torah is telling you. Yeshua is saying exactly what Torah is. He's saying that the tradition was, I got to bring to God first. God understands. God owns 1,000 cattle on 1,000 hill. What he said first is take care of the poor. Honor your father and mother, okay? Well, if Dad's an alcoholic, well, I'm not going to keep helping you because you need to be taken by the demon, okay? If he's going against the word of God and drugs or whatever, fornication, you got to let them go because God says remove them from your community. But if your father had a heart attack, you have to take care of the family if you're old enough to take care. Honor. This is your duty. This is what category 8 is all about. Honoring, how do I honor my father in heaven if I don't honor my father on earth if he's a godly man? And we see so many families throughout the globe that are broken because dad has left. And the children don't understand honor. They don't have dignity. They don't have a good family name anymore because it's all about you instead of all about the father. Honor your father. Do what is needed. Now, turn to Colossians. Colossians 3, verse 20. Colossians 3, verse 20. Oh, no, here Paul, he's talking and not contradicting the Torah. Children, obey your parents in everything, for this pleases the Lord. Oh my goodness, he's talking about category 8. He's confirming the law. Children, obey your parents. Oh, that's terrible. I thought Paul said we don't have to follow the law anymore, Paul. No, he's confirming it. Children, obey your parents. Why? That's going to bring you blessings. It's going to bring you long life. Honor your father in heaven by honoring your parents here on earth. For this pleases the Lord. I thought, Paul, we don't have to circumcise anymore. We can eat pig because Kepha had a vision and he never ate the food. Okay? What pleases the Lord? Following this commandment. Aleph, Beit, Gimel, Dalet. Hey, number 5. Oh, 5, the number of grace. All right, going back now to category 9. Category 9, turn to Leviticus 18, verse 7. Category 9, Leviticus 18, verse 7. This category is entitled Forbidden Sexual Relations. Forbidden Sexual Relations. And subcategory is called Not to Commit Incest with One's Mother. This is just disgusting. But understand, God wrote it so it was happening. Okay? And it's still happening even more so today. What was the story last week? A homo man wanted to marry his now homo son. Leviticus 18, verse 7. You are not to have sexual relations with your father, and you're not to have sexual relations with your mother. She is your mother. Do not have sexual relations with you, with her, with her. That's pretty self-explanatory, but I'll explain it anyway. Okay? Now, just think, this was written a couple of thousand years ago. And God, you know, people were doing this stuff. So God, so should we now get rid of this? Yes, my mom's a foxy lady. You know, she just got her butt lifted and she got lips done and she got her breasts augmented. Yes, you know, she's a fine looking mama. Mama. You know, so you know, do you see the unrealistic understanding that most people have, you know, that just follow the New Testament? No. And you can't say, well, we got to do this one, but we don't have to do this one. We got to keep the Sabbath, but we keep it on Sunday now. Yeah, and we can eat pork now, but we can't have sex with our mothers. How do you come up with these rules? Okay, God said don't do it. You know, there's a whole medical understanding about doing it because anything that's a bad trait in the family will be exacerbated by the relation. When God brings a child, the child's going to be so messed up physically because the gene pool is totally bad. So everything that's in the family is now going to be ding, 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 ding. Okay? Hey, here we are. Uh-huh. Mom was looking fine. No, don't do it. Okay, Leviticus 18 is where all this stuff is. Okay, now let's see if that's in the Brit Hadashah. Let's now go to Revelation 22. Let's see if category 9 is in the Brit Hadashah. Forbidden sexual relations. Revelation 22, verse 15. Last chapter, go all the way to your end and let's flip over that last page. Okay? Revelation 22, verse 15. Revelation 22, 15. I'm not going to give you that long to find it because it's easy. Outside are the homosexuals, those involved with the occult and with drugs, the sexually immoral, murderers, idol worshippers, and everyone who loves and practices falsehood. So here we're just going to focus on the sexually immoral. Okay? What is sexually immoral? Don't have sex with your mother. Okay? Now it goes further. Okay? So we're going to go through this a bunch of times in this particular category because it's encompassed in one verse in the Brit Hadashah many times. Because sexually immoral, you'll see immorality in some translations. Well, what is immorality? Well, don't have sex with your mother or your father. Daughters, don't have sex with your father. We have a tremendous amount of that stuff going on. Fathers are raping their daughters left and right. Because why? We don't teach the law of God. It is a rampant, disgusting thing that is going on around the globe. And it's so rampant in Islam. All the what's going on in Europe, you should read the reports about what's going on. These poor little girls, most of them want to die. One girl was raped 31 times in 2 hours. 2 hours by family members. Family members. Great, guys. You guys are champions. Let me get a machete out for you. We're going to circumcise you. Next slide. Next slide. We're going now to the final category of this particular era of Shabbat teaching. We're going back to the book of Numbers. Numbers chapter 10. We're going to category 10. Category 10 is times and seasons. Times and seasons. This is tonight. The subcategory is called that the new month shall be solemnly proclaimed as holy. So let's do it. Since tonight is the beginning of the ninth month that we're recording this. Let's read Numbers chapter 10, verse 10. Also on your days of rejoicing at your designated times and on Rosh Chodesh, which is tonight, you are to sound the trumpets over your burnt offerings and over the sacrifices of your peace offerings. These will be your reminder before your Elohim. I am Yehovah your Elohim. You're to sound the shofar, especially today. Well, one, it's Shabbat. It's a double sounding, but also the moon was sighted in Eretz Yisrael. There was a picture here in New Jersey. We had two pictures, one from Pastor Ed's wife, Veronica the Harmonica, and one from Joshua, who took pictures of the Rosh Kodesh, and we have that. So we're times and seasons. We have to remember what day it is. We begin the ninth month, which is the month of the dedication. We see the Feast of Hanukkah in John chapter 10, verse 22. And we see Hanukkah in the Tanakh in 2 Chronicles 7. Now let's go on to our last slide for tonight. Proclaimed as holy, Luke chapter 22. Luke chapter 22, verse 19. Luke chapter 22, things that are holy convocations, times and seasons. Luke 22, verse 19. Luke 22. 19. Also taking the piece of matzah, he made a bracha, broken and gave it to them and said, this What? What a technology fascinating night we've had here tonight. Don't worry, we're going to keep plugging along. Why? Because you're not going to win, Satan. This is my battery, okay? Let's read it again. It was so good, Satan didn't want to hear it. Also taking a piece of matzah, he made a bracha, broken and gave it to them and said, this is my body, which is being given for you. It is filled with power. Do this in memory of me. Okay, this is what Yeshua was sitting, not at the Last Supper, but at Pesach, or actually at that point, it had gone into Hag Matzah, most likely. Now let's really take it, you know, because people always want to say, Paul comments against the Torah. Let's turn to Colossians again. I just love how this is just rolling out. Colossians chapter 2, verse 16 and 17. Hopefully all you that are listening to this teaching are being blessed and learning more about your Lord and about the Scriptures. Okay, there we see wonderful Miss Elizabeth sitting there at the desk. Hi, Elizabeth, I just looked over here. All right, last one. Colossians 2, verse 16 and 17. So don't let anyone pass judgment on you in connection with your with eating and drinking or in regard to a Jewish festival or Rosh Chodesh or Shabbat. These are a shadow of things that are coming, but the body is of the Messiah. So here Paul is confirming, don't let the pagans, the heathen, pass judgment on you. Okay? That you're doing what God wants in regards to a Rosh Chodesh. So if you're sounding a shofar and the church is like, what are you doing? That's Jewish. Well, you tell them to turn to Colossians 2 and verse, look at verse 16 and say, well, we're supposed to sound it because it's the Rosh Chodesh. A Rosh what? Read your Bible. Okay, don't just read the parts you like. Read the whole thing from beginning to end. Okay? So don't look at verse 16 again. So don't let anyone pass judgment on you in connection with eating or drinking or in regard to a Jewish festival or Rosh Chodesh or Shabbat. Okay? It probably says new moon or Sabbath in your English translations. Okay? Rosh Chodesh, what we have tonight. We see the moon. Okay? Start Rosh Chodesh. Sound the shofar everywhere, all throughout the land. Because why? It's a double blessing because the Rosh Chodesh has landed on our Shabbat. Well, we have gotten through all the categories, and this is the absolute truth, the 613 mitzvah, the truth. It's the new hay speech, because you know why? We say you got to follow the commandments. I bid you an amen and an amen.
Shalom. This is Messianic Rabbi Andrew Dinnerman. I would personally like to thank you for tuning in to the Remnant's Call each and every week. You can listen to the full message on our website, bethgoyim.org. If you have drawn closer to the King of Kings, learned more about Him today, we are blessed. If you are blessed by these messages, please consider a donation to our ministry. You can go to our website, bethgoyim.org. That's bethgoyim.org. And click on the donate button. You do not have to have a PayPal account to donate. All you need is a debit card. Once again, thank you very much for listening to The Remnant's Call.
If you have not taken your first steps to be born again, just ask God's help. Remember, it's His loving grace that has come to find you. No one is worthy or able to reach God, but God can reach us, and He's reaching out to you now. Just open your heart and let Him in. His arms are open, and the blessing of salvation and eternal life are waiting for you. Don't let it wait any longer.
Shalom. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord lift His face and shine upon you. May the Lord be gracious unto you and give you His shalom.
Shalom. My name is Messianic Rabbi Andrew Dinnerman, and I invite you to come to visit our congregation. If you are in the tri-state area, come out and visit with us on Shabbat. We are a congregation of Jews and Gentiles living as one in the Messiah Yeshua. BGMC is a place of true worship. The focus never wanders from the Hebraic roots of our faith. Beth Goyim is rooted in the Word of God from Bereshit through to the Book of Revelation. Messiah's strong words against man-made tradition are carefully recorded in Matthew 7. That is the reason we only follow the straight-up instructions found in Scripture. Truly, the way, the truth, and the life. If you're looking for a deeper walk with Adonai, come out for our Tuesday evening Bible study called Messianic Torah Time. Come, spend a day with us on any Shabbat. We start at 11 a.m. with the sound of the ancient Hebrew shofar. Next, we offer our King praise and worship in English, Hebrew, and Spanish. After worship, we review the headlines in the previous week's news from around the globe, especially news from the Holy Land, Israel. We don't just list the news headlines as current events, but we comb through the scriptures, searching for clues to understand what they mean, and then to help pinpoint prophetically our current position on Adonai's clock. After digesting all that modern information, we leave the world behind as we journey with our Adonai deep into his eternal word, not with just one or two scriptures, but usually seven or more scriptures. The spiritual nourishment and the richness of his kingdom become accessible to the ones who share this special time and seek them out. The day does not end there. Because Shabbat is so special to him, there is always so much more that our King desires to share. So instead of separating and leaving, we stay together as a family for potluck lunch and an afternoon study of our King's Word. We close the Shabbat together with a reading of the new week's parasha. That's the Torah portion. Even after those blessings, many of us just can't get enough. So the members bring prepared homemade foods to share while we all enjoy an uplifting movie together. If all that information is not quite enough, you can check out our website where you will find over 200 video teachings and biblical holy day studies. Under Messianic Torah Time, the Hebrew Roots button, you'll discover free studies on many, many different topics, including PowerPoint slide presentations. If Beth Goyim sounds like a place you'd love to visit, but you live outside the tri-state area, there is still a way to connect with us. We stream live on the internet on Tuesday, Thursday, and Shabbat. The website is www.bethgoyim.org. That's BETHGOYIM.org. Our phone number is 973-338-7800 or 978-2-YESHUA. That's 978, the number 2, Yeshua. Shalom.